morning, sir. I'm Sri Lakshmi. The case I'm presenting is of a 61-year-old female hailing from Vaipin. Her preceding complaints were fever with chills and rigors for 1 week and cough with sputum for 4 days. History of preceding complaint. The patient was apparently asymptomatic 1 week back when she developed sudden onset of high-grade fever, which was intermittent in nature, was associated with chills and rigors, and also associated with headache, myalgia, reduced appetite, and fatigability. She also complains of cough since 4 days, which was insidious in onset, aggravates during night, no relieving factors, no postural variation, no associated chest pain or wheeze. Cough was associated with sputum, which was mucoid and scanty. She also gave history of travel outside Kerala 1 month back. She stayed in a rural area, but she did not give any history of unwell contacts around. No history of neck pain or vomiting. No history of rash, no history of burning pain while micturation, no history of jaundice, no history of diarrhea. Past history, she is a known case of systemic hypertension since 10 years and she is on medication. And she had history of pneumonia for which she was hospitalized 6 years ago. She has no history of diabetes mellitus, tuberculosis or COVID-19 infection. No significant past surgical history. Personal history, she gives history of reduced sleep and reduced appetite for the past 1 week. And she consumes vegetarian diet and she has normal bowel and bladder habits. Family history, no significant family history. So moving on to examination.
Drug history? Sir? Drug. What drugs she is taking?
Sir, currently she was taking, for hypertension she was taking losartan 20 milligrams.
So do you want to know the drug history in this case?
Yes, sir.
Why?
Drug-induced fever.
Drug-induced fever, you can get in short duration of drugs, not she is taking for a long time. What else? Because some drugs like beta blockers can reduce the heart rate.
Yes.
Like somebody is having fever, normally you expect a high heart rate. But if they are taking beta blocker, the heart rate will come down. If the patient is having fever and low heart rate, enteric fever is one differential diagnosis. But when the patient is on beta blocker, that type of clinical feature you can see. Another this one is when the patient is having fever, they have hypotension. So better to avoid that day's antihypertensive when the patient is already having low BP. Better to avoid that drug during that period, give fluids, and once the BP is becoming normal, you can continue the antihypertensive. So you should be very careful. Whatever antihypertensive patient is taking, we should know that. You have to sometimes modify the regime according to the clinical situation. But never stop the drug abruptly, because the patient who is on beta blockers, suddenly if you withdraw, there will be rapid heart rate, reflex tachycardia.
So moving on to examination, patient was conscious, cooperative, oriented to time, place and person, moderately built and nourished, no pallor, icterus, clubbing.
Patient is oriented to time, place and person. What does it mean? Why we are taking that history?
Altered mental status.
Some patients can have altered mental status on depending on they may not know what is the time. So they are not oriented to time. Some patients are not oriented to the person. Like they are not able to identify whether the person is looking after is his son or daughter or relative. He will not be able to identify. Face recognition will be a problem in some patients. So time and all other features. Time, person, and all these things should be proper when we are examining a case, especially neurological case. And somebody is having encephalitis also, this is very important. Okay.
So no pallor, icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, lymphadenopathy or edema. So vitals, her pulse rate was 112 per minute, normal rhythm, volume, character, no radio-radial delay or no radiofemoral delay, peripheral pulses were palpable.
Is pulse is important in
yes.
a fever patient?
Yes, sir.
Why?
Sir, usually for every Fahrenheit, pulse rate increases by 10.
Okay.
And in case of dengue or
typhoid
fever, we'll get relative bradycardia.
Okay.
And if there is disproportionately tachycardia, we can think of myocarditis.
Myocardial involvement or myocardial dysfunction,
yes,
or myocarditis, all these things. Okay. And some patients, you can get absent pulses when there is fever.
Tachyosis
disease. So pulse is very important. You have to examine the pulse in detail in a case of fever.
Temperature was 101 degree Fahrenheit. Respiratory rate was 20 per minute, abdominal thoracic type. BP was 110/80 mmHg, taking in the left arm in sitting posture in with
ideally you have to examine the BP in standing posture in a patient who is having fever, because postural hypotension is one of the earliest sign of fluid reductions. Like they can have fluid loss, a lot of fluid loss can occur in fever patients. They can have postural hypotension, that is the earliest sign of loss of fluid. Okay, so ideally check the BP in standing position also.
Systemic examination. So in this case, I started with respiratory system because the patient also present with cough with sputum.
Okay. Okay.
On inspection, the upper respiratory tract appeared to be normal. No paranasal sinus tenderness. On inspection, chest position of trachea appeared to be central. Shape of the chest was normal. Movements appeared to be symmetrical. No indrawing of intercostal space with inspiration, no usage of accessory muscles of respiration, no drooping of shoulder, no supraclavicular or infraclavicular hollowness. Skin over the chest will appear to be normal, no dilated veins, scars or sinuses. Palpation, trachea was found to be central, no local rise in temperature or tenderness. Chest expansion was 3 cm and normal symmetrical chest movements bilaterally. Apex beat was felt at the 5th left intercostal space, 1.5 cm medial to the midclavicular line. Vocal fremitus was resonant in all areas. Percussion, liver dullness was felt in the 5th right intercostal space. Auscultation, normal vesicular breath sounds were heard. No added sounds. Vocal resonance were normal in all areas. So then I proceeded on to gastrointestinal system, sir. On inspection, abdomen.
Always examine the oral cavity first in GIT examination, because fever patients, you can get diabetic patient, lot of gingivitis, caries tooth, all these things can produce fever. Sinuses and oral cavity is very important.
So inspection, shape of the abdomen appeared to be normal, not distended, flanks were not full, all quadrants were moving equally with respiration, skin over the abdomen appeared to be normal. No dilated veins, scars, sinuses, hernial orifices appear normal, umbilicus was midline and inverted. On palpation, there was no local rise in temperature or tenderness, no hepatosplenomegaly, liver border was soft, regular and normal in consistency. On percussion, the liver span was 10 cm, liver dullness was felt at the right 5th intercostal space, no shifting dullness. On auscultation, normal bowel sounds were heard. So, rest of the systems were
normal. So, here you have a patient who is having fever with chills and rigor, female patient.
Yes.
What are the common conditions which can present like this?
So, for urinary tract infection.
Urinary tract infection is the most common condition then.
So, then we, since she also has a history of travel outside India, so we can also think of malaria.
Malaria. Can you think about pneumonia consolidation here?
Yes, sir. Patient also present with cough.
But pneumonia. Here you are not getting any clinical signs of pneumonia. Is it possible?
No, sir.
It's possible, because any lesion more than 5 centimeters in the lung, deeper in 5 centimeters, you don't expect to get any clinical findings. Okay. So when you are having a deep lesion, like a deep pneumonia, like if the lesion is away from the superficial part, then you don't get any clinical finding. You need to take an X-ray or ultrasound to know that. So there also, it is also possible, but since you are not getting any clinical findings, we move away from that and we can think about urinary tract infection or malaria.
Yes.
So if you are not getting clinical sign, means it is, we should not think that it is not there. It can be still there. Okay, we are not getting. Okay.
Yes. So we'll have to proceed with investigation,
okay.
Sir.
What are the basic investigation you'll ask in a fever patient?
So we'll have to go for complete.
Here patient come with cough and fever. First investigation will be chest X-ray. So normally when you are seeing a patient like this, we always take a chest X-ray, because we already discussed it. We can clinically miss the findings. X-ray may not miss it. So take an X-ray, see that there is no consolidation or pneumonitis, all these things. Okay. So take an X-ray first, then we can proceed with other investigation.
So, ruling out infectious diseases, we have to go with CBC or peripheral blood smear.
Okay.
And in case of malaria, we'll have to go for peripheral blood smear, either thick smear or
both. We have to do thick smear and thin smear. One will detect whether parasite is there, other one detect species. What is the type of parasite.
Then in case of malaria, we'll have to go for other investigations like quantitative buffy coat layer for malaria.
QBCMP, yes. Quantitative buffy coating.
Then plasmodium LDH and plus for histine rich protein.
Okay, most common test used in India is QBC for QBC MP.
QBCP.
Okay. Malaria antigen also there. In our ABG machine, we can get there will be pointing towards that malaria parasite is present or not. It will not detect exactly, but it may give a clue that in that ABG machine. Okay. Continue. What happened to this investigation?
So in this patient, the peripheral blood smear showed malarial parasites.
Okay. What type of malarial parasite?
So, it was Plasmodium vivax.
Okay. Which is more dangerous, vivax or
Plasmodium falciparum.
Falciparum. Why falciparum is dangerous?
So, falciparum because it can affect all types of RBC at all stages, sir.
Okay.
And
cerebral malaria.
What is that?
So, GCS of less than 11.
No. That is correct. What you are telling is clinical finding. Why patient develops all this complication in falciparum malaria?
So, that's because of cytoadherence leading to microcirculatory blood.
It blocks the microcirculation. That's why it produces all problems like encephalitis, hepatitis, kidney failure. Everywhere it produces a problem because it blocks the microcirculation. And it affects all age group of RBCs. Comparing to other one, this affects all age group and it produces microcirculation blockage. Okay.
So leading to further complications like cerebral malaria.
Okay. What is cerebral malaria?
So GCS of less than 11 along with features like seizures.
Patient can have seizure, but seizure does not, post seizure patient can have confusion. That is not cerebral malaria. You should not confuse with that. Cerebral malaria, in that cerebral malaria, patient can have seizure. Okay, patient is having altered behavior, patient still can have seizure. But somebody is having seizure because of some other reason, like patient may be on quinine, it can produce an arrhythmia, that produce seizure-like activity. Patient will have hypoglycemia, that produce some seizure-like activity. All those things, patient can have altered behavior. That is not cerebral malaria. Cerebral malaria means without seizure itself, patient is having altered behavior. And in that patient, patient can have a seizure. Okay. So, definition-wise, there is slightly difference, seizure will not produce cerebral malaria. Cerebral malaria can produce seizure. Okay.
So, then other complications like hypoglycemia or pulmonary edema.
Okay.
Or
why hypoglycemia occurs in malaria?
So, because of reduced hepatic gluconeogenesis, or it can also be related to quinine.
Increase the amount of insulin in our body. Say insulin secrete, so that produces hypoglycemia. Hepatic glucose production is reduced. That also produces. This parasite utilizes glucose. That also produces hypoglycemia. So all three mechanism can produce hypoglycemia. It is very very common in falciparum malaria.
So other complications like anemia can occur.
Anemia is due to?
So due to reduced hematopoiesis and erythrocyte survival is also less.
Hemolysis can occur due to two reasons. One is spleen, enlarged spleen can destroy platelets. That is tropical splenomegaly syndrome. There you can get hemolysis. Malaria itself can destroy RBCs. That is another reason. So it can be due to hemolysis inside the spleen or intravascular hemolysis.
So then shock due to gram-negative septicemia.
Okay, this is called as?
Algid
malaria. Okay.
So then renal failure, sir.
Okay.
And,
so you know all these complications and how do you treat this malaria case?
So the malaria can be usually treated, can be either chloroquine resistant or chloroquine sensitive. So
okay, in India, predominantly it is chloroquine resistant. So we should not think about chloroquine sensitive malaria. We are not getting that type of cases. It's all chloroquine resistant. But however, we should know the chloroquine dose. What is chloroquine dose?
So chloroquine, tab chloroquine 600 milligrams stat and then followed by.
You should remember that you don't get chloroquine tablet, you get chloroquine. Sulfate. That 250 milligram chloroquine sulfate contains 150 milligram base. So, four tablets will be 600 milligram. Okay.
Then followed by 300 milligram at 0.
Okay.
I mean at 6 hours, 12 hours, and 24 hours.
Okay. So that is chloroquine. chloroquine is no like suppose chloroquine resistance is there, or we know that already chloroquine. What other drugs you can use?
So drug of choice is artesunate. In case of mild malaria, we'll go for tab artesunate. If that is around 120 milligram start, followed by 60 milligram every day for five days. Sir.
Okay.
Along with that, we'll have to give single dose of sulfur dioxide and pyrimethamine single dose.
Okay.
And in case and other drug alternative drug is tab quinine.
Okay.
It can be given.
Previously, quinine was the drug of choice. Nowadays, we are not using quinine because of its arrhythmogenic potency.
And
we are using syngonism is another problem. What is syngonism?
So vertigo. I mean nystagmus.
Tinnitus, vertigo, nystagmus. Yes. Okay. And so it produces hypoglycemia also. It sometimes produces arrhythmias like torsades pointis.
So in case of severe malaria, we'll go for injection
IV injection. Okay.
Artesunate. If the patient is more than 20 kilogram, we'll go for 2.4 milligram per kilogram body weight stat.
Okay.
And followed by 2.4 milligram per kilogram body weight at 12 hours and 24 hours respectively, and once daily.
Okay.
Along with tab doxycycline 100 milligram BD for 7 days.
Okay. Pregnant ladies?
Pregnant.
Same thing. Pregnancy also, same drug can be used. Okay. There is no contraindication. Okay.
In case of less than 20 kilogram body weight, so we'll have to go for 3 milligram per kilogram body weight.
Okay. Does chloroquine has got anti-inflammatory action?
Hydroxychloroquine.
Both chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine is used as anti-inflammatory drugs. So when the patient is having fever and they are allergic, many patients are allergic to paracetamol. So if you are treating with chloroquine, that itself can reduce the fever. Okay. So no need to add another drug to reduce the fever. Most of the time, second day onwards, fever will come down only because of chloroquine. So if the patient is allergic to paracetamol, NSAID and all, there is no need to add another drug when you are treating with this type of drugs. Okay. So if suppose this patient is again going to that endemic area, what else you can give?
Chemoprophylaxis
with
doxycycline,
chloroquine, mefloquine. Again, it is divided into chloroquine resistant and chloroquine sensitive. Chloroquine sensitive, you can give chloroquine. Otherwise, mefloquine or doxycycline can be given. Doxycycline can be used in other type of prophylaxis also, other bacterial prophylaxis, like leptospirosis. So when there is flood and all, we can use mefloquine with doxycycline, because both are very common in that type of areas, so we can prevent that. Okay?
Yes.
Thank you.